today. And if you can sing a little harmony, do that. And if you can only make a joyful noise, do that. And if you can't carry a tune in a bucket, just sing real softly.
Man, we're going to sing He Keeps Me Singing. Man, do you have a song in your heart today? Amen, yes. Amen. Sing. There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. All my life was wrecked by sin and strife. Discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus swept across the broken strings, stirred the slumbering chords again. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Feasting on the riches of His grace, resting neath His sheltering wings, always looking on His smiling face. That is why I shout and sing. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Though sometimes He leads through waters deep, trials fall across the way. Though sometimes the path seems rough and steep, see His footprints all the way. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Soon He's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown. I shall reign with Him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Kills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Jesus is the one that keeps us singing, and He's the only hope we have for heaven. Amen. The Bible said there's no other name given among men whereby we must be saved. And the world hates the name of Jesus, but we love the name of Jesus. I want to say we're glad to have all of our boys and girls that come on the bus ministry. And Brother Eddie, thank you for picking them up. And it's good to have all of our guests here this morning. If this is your first time to be in church with us, we count you as a guest, not as a visitor. Visitors are people that just show up and that you don't care whether they're there or not. Guests is people that we're glad you're here. And we're glad that each one of you are here this morning. I was sharing before church, and y'all just remain standing for a minute. We're going to do something else. But I was sharing with a gentleman just before church that we made up of three parts: this physical body that'll die, go back to the dust from whence it came, and then inside of us is the soul of man, which is the real person. It's the real you, the real me, that'll live on through eternity with all the memory, feelings, and everything. I mean, it's the real person. And then each one of us have a spirit. God gave us a spirit. And before you get saved, the devil guides you, and he directs you by your spirit. But after you get saved, that's what Jesus is talking about. You must be born again. Your spirit is what gets born again. Then you got a new director in your life, and he starts guiding you in a good direction. And we encourage you today, open your spirit that God can do something special in your life in this service. Amen. We're going to have some music put on. I want you to get out and shake hands and greet our guests. And if you see some church member that looks a little grouchy, shake their hands and put a smile on their face. Amen. Lord bless you. We're going to have some music. Get out and shake hands with folks. Tell them you're glad to see them in church today.
Well, I want to say with Brother Thomas and just echo, we are so glad all of you are here this morning. And we come to church because we want the Lord to do a work in our lives. And so I just encourage you this morning, and I want to say this because I understand when you go to a new place and you don't know anybody, and they're doing things differently, and you know, it's a lot to take in. And a lot of times you're just kind of checking things out. But I just want to encourage you, you can put down all of your walls and defenses, because we're not going to do anything to you. We're not going to force you into anything. We're just going to try and let the Lord love you through us, through the preaching, and through everything we do here this morning. So relax and let God do what He wants to do. Open your spirit up and let the Lord minister to you today, because you would hate to go to all the effort to come to church and miss something that the Lord wanted to do for you and in your life. So I want to say I appreciate you for being here, and just let God have His way. I know this is kind of our religious calisthenics, up and down, up and down, up and down. But if y'all would stand one more time, Brother Steve's going to lead us in one more song. Amen. Let's worship as we sing.
Amen. Well, let's sing when we all get to heaven. Amen. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory.
Thank you, Brother Steve. You may be seated. And that is going to be a wonderful time when we get to heaven. Amen. Come on, guys. That's fine. Y'all stand up here. Amen. I wanted to say just a little bit about the children. The reason that I put such emphasis on us picking up children. They have little chance of having a good life outside of God directing and guiding them because this world is totally messed up. The doctrine, the teachings, and everything. And I just praise the Lord that this church cares about the children, that we have a bus ministry, and we get out on the streets and visit with people and try to encourage them for their children. But listen to what the Bible says about what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 18, verse 5. It said, "For whosoever shall receive one of such little children in my name receiveth me." So the Lord is pleased with anybody that cares for the children. And, of course, I would say beyond the caring for the children, just being to where you care for other people in the place of spending all of our time trying to look out for ourselves. Amen. You'll always find that life is better when you're trying to be a blessing to somebody else. I promise you that. We get so caught up in looking at our needs and our desires until many times we lose focus of what God really would plan for our lives and be to where we can enjoy the good life. The good life is given to others and being a blessing to them. And I just want to say, this church loves you folks. If this is your first time, we love you being here, and we want to be a blessing to you any way we can. And by the way, our friend back here, I wish he had brought his guitar. We're going to have a guitar player. If he brings his guitar, just put it in the car and bring it with him. Amen. But what talent you have, we want to make it to where you can use it for God. Amen. Okay, without any further ado, I'm going to receive the morning tithe and offer and give you opportunity to give. It's such a privilege to be able to give to God because He's the one that provides for us. And I say I appreciate so much folks that have taken hold of the Scripture and they believe the Word of God, to where they give the Lord a chance to bless them, as I have through the years been blessed of the Lord because I put Him first. And I'd encourage you to do the same thing with paying your tithes, giving in offerings. And then on the communion table here, if you have a dollar that you could put on that to go into the benevolence fund to help people that's struggling, people that's having it worse than we are, because the Lord wants us to be a part of helping them too. Amen. All of this is given to the Lord. Amen. And we're glad to have you here to be a part of that. Brother Braden, would you pray over the offering this morning?
Yes. Amen.
Amen. Thank you for your giving. And I forgot to mention before we received the offering, if you filled out a visitor's card or a guest card, and you wasn't able to put it in the offering, we could have an usher to pick it up. If you just hold up your hand if you didn't put yours in the offering bag. I guess everybody did, but we wanted to be sure and get that. And what we do, I just encourage you to be sure that you, if you didn't fill out a guest card or a visitor's card, be sure and do that, because we do want to put you on the prayer list to be praying for you and praying for your family. Amen. And we're glad you're here today. I want to say thank you for your being faithful to give. Amen. Well, at this time, we're going to dismiss our children to Children's Church. Let's give them a good hand as they go out. Appreciate the workers too. Amen. We dismissed a good part of our church, didn't we? That's wonderful. That's wonderful. They can hear the gospel. And I just say to y'all, Brother Gary's going to be preaching just in a minute. Brother Steve, did you bring a? You didn't. Well, it was a good thought. Some of that canned music to get by. Hey, listen, we do have good music here at this church. It's just that we don't have a lot of people that play instruments, but we do have good music and good singing. But it did sound like a little bit like Church of Christ this morning. We did sing to the Lord, though. Amen. Amen. Well, I've probably taken up enough time, but Brother Steve, was you going to sing or not? Okay, I'll turn it over to Brother Gary. If he wants to get you to sing, just twist his arm or whatever. I appreciate my son, and I feel like that he definitely seeks the Lord to have a word from the Lord. And I do need to tell you this, that God does direct our paths if we ask him to. And there's been times that I went somewhere and I didn't get all done that I needed to get done in talking to somebody about the Lord, and he sent me back for whatever reason. I mean, it might be a flat tire or whatever, but he wants to get the message across because he loves people. It's not his will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And I had a lady ask me this morning, did we do communion? And we do communion. We've been a little negligent, but we are going to be serving communion. And I could tell you a lot of things. And hopefully in the future, we'll give you a little bit more instruction on the doctrinal of what the Bible teaches about how we to live and what we to do. But at this time, I'm going to turn it over to Brother Gary, and he's going to be preaching for us.
Thanks, Dad. Well, I thank you, Dad. And I was going to tell you something kind of humorous. I last week, we went down to Joplin and then on over into Ava, Missouri, and we stopped on Saturday in Springfield and ate breakfast at a place called Billy Gale's. And if you ever threw that way, it's worth stopping there. They serve 14-inch pancakes. I got an omelet, and I had no idea that thing was a 5-egg omelet. It was huge. But it was kind of a country setting, you know, and had all these signs up and everything. And I took a picture of a couple of these signs. One of them said, "This killing them with kindness is taking way too long." And I saw another one that said, "So when does this old enough to know better kick in?" You ever felt like that? And tell you one more thing I thought was funny I saw this week. I saw a video of Ronald Reagan telling a story about this little boy. And he was at the Democratic convention, and he was outside the convention, and all these people was coming and going, and he had a little box set up there, And of course, the you know, all the reporters are there and everything, and they're, you know, interviewing people. And this little boy sitting right up there by the door, and he's got a box and he's got a big sign, says, and calling to people, "Hey, buy your Democratic kittens. Buy your Democratic kittens." And in his box, he had a litter of these kittens, and they were just one day old. They hadn't even opened their eyes yet. They're just little old bitty kittens, you know. And he's up there trying to sell these kittens, and everybody's just coming and going. Well, the Democratic convention ended, and about a month later, they had the Republican convention. And same little boy there at the door, "Buy your Republican kittens. Buy your Republican kittens." And so this reporter, she came up to him and she said, "Son," she said, "I saw you last month at the Democratic convention saying that these kittens were Democrat kittens." And she said, "Now they're Republican kittens." She said, what's the deal?" He said, "Well, that's easy. Last month they didn't have their eyes open yet." So anyway, we need to get our eyes open, don't we? If you have your Bibles, turn with me, if you would, to Proverbs chapter 24, verse 16. If you would stand, please, for the reading of God's Word. Brother Steve, I would have had you sing, but I figured you had already stood up here with no music long enough. The Bible just simply says here in Proverbs 24:16, "For the just man falleth seven times and riseth up again. But the wicked shall fall into mischief." Brother Josh Webster, would you please pray that God would anoint the next little bit with us? Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. I think it was maybe Tuesday, I was driving a truck, and if I'm not mistaken, I was on 115. And I don't know, a lot of times messages and sermons come to me through different experiences that I have throughout the week, and I think about things, but this was a very different type of an experience that I had. I wasn't thinking about this at all, and this scripture popped in my mind just out of nowhere. And it came to me instantaneously, the thought of, "I'm getting up. I'm getting up." And if the Lord will help me today for a few minutes, I want to talk to you on that thought of, "I'm getting up." I do not want this message today to sound like a motivational speech, but I do want to encourage and challenge some of you to get up. To get up. I'm going to read just a few scriptures in way of getting to my message. But in Proverbs 6 and 9, the Bible says, "How long wilt thou sleep, O sluggard? When wilt thou arise out of thy sleep? Yet a little sleep and a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to sleep, so shall thy poverty come as one that travaileth, and thy want as an armed man." It is time to wake up. It's time to get up. The Lord is coming for people who are looking and watching and waiting for His return. Matter of fact, the scripture in John chapter 11, verse 11, I thought this was interesting, talking about Lazarus. Lazarus had died, and they had already buried him, and the Lord was in another place ministering to people. And then He said this, He said, "These things said He, and after He said unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may wake him out of sleep." And I thought, well, that's a message right there. The Lord comes to wake people up. Amen. You may get in this service today, and through the preaching, the Holy Spirit might come and tap you on the shoulder and say, it's time to get up. It's time to get up. And I don't know how it was in your house growing up, but in my house, I've said this before, but my mother was much more gentle in waking us kids up in the mornings. She would come in, and it'd be time for school, and she'd say, Gary, it's time to get up. You're real soft and gentle, you know, and then I would sleep through that. And then the next time, Gary, come on, it's time to get up. My dad did not take that approach. His approach was much more direct. He would come in and say, son, put your feet on the floor. That was his wake-up call. Put your feet on the floor. And I knew that there was no second calling. There was no snooze button. When Dad said, it's time to get up, it was time to get up. And interestingly enough, I knew that I could maneuver with both of those approaches. And I could deal with both of those approaches. Now, I didn't like my dad's approach near as much as I liked my mom's approach. I liked the patient, gentle nudging, right? But when the time demanded it and it was necessary, I could deal with the son, put your feet on the floor. Well, the question I have for us today is, what time is it? And in Romans chapter 13, verse 11, the Bible says, and that knowing the time, that now it is high time to wake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. I just want to tell you today, you don't want to sleep through what's coming next. You do not want to be asleep when things start happening that's fixing to start happening. You see, I believe, and I wouldn't say that I'm a great scholar of the Bible, but I believe from my reading and my study and everything I've learned, the next thing on God's calendar is the rapture of the church. I believe that every prophecy has been fulfilled, and we are waiting for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the devil's approach to all of this busyness and all of this chaos in the world is to either scare people into hiding or rock them to sleep with entertainment and pleasure and the making of money, and their spiritual senses are going to sleep. And I just want to say today, Lord, I'm getting up. I am getting up. Hallelujah. And I think it's high time that a lot of people wake up and get up. Amen? Amen. So for those of you who like kind of catchy phrases or word analogies, today all of my points are going to be talking about the just. The Bible said in our text verse, the just man falleth seven times and riseth up again. So I want to talk today about the just man getting up. Number one, I want to talk about the conditions of the just. The conditions of the just. And I want to say this, and I think every one of us could agree, and we've been there. Sometimes I'm up, and sometimes I'm down. But if I am down, you can know one thing. I'm getting back up. I'm getting back up. For you see, the just is nothing more than an equal balance. And what makes a man just is not how many times he falls down, but rather if every time he falls down, he equalizes that with a get up, he's now just. Did you catch that? It don't matter how many times you've failed. It don't matter how many times that you have stumbled. It don't matter how many times you've blown it. It don't matter how many times you've got discouraged. It don't matter how many times you've found yourself down. As long as you, by the grace of God, can reach a hand up and say, God, I'm getting up. And you get up, you are just in the sight of God, because a just man falls seven times. But I'm getting up again. Amen. I'm getting up. Everybody say it with me. I'm getting up. I'm getting up. Hallelujah. The devil wants to keep you down. He wants you to fall, and he wants you to lay there in guilt and shame. He wants you to lay there in depression and fear, and he wants you to stay down by telling you there's no need in you getting up again, because you're just going to fall again. But I want to tell you something this morning, and I want to serve notice on the devil. I'm getting up. I'm getting up. I'm not going to stay down. I'm getting up. The condition of the just man is not the fact that he failed, but the condition of the just man is I'm getting up. I'm getting up. We're all candidates for getting up because we've all failed. We have fallen into sin. We have fallen into temptation. We have broken things. We have fallen into brokenness. How many of you guys have ever had a broken heart? Raise your hand. You had some little gal, you know, when you was little, you know, blink them little eyes, and you just fell head over heels. And then 3 weeks later, you learned that she was not the one. The first crush I ever had was on a girl. I was 4 years old, and she was 17, Robbie Riley. I fell head over heels in love with this girl. Another girl, I always liked older women. I was 12, and there was this girl that came to our church, and she was about, she's 18 or 19 years old. And I asked her if she'd like me. And she said, well, when you get your first hair on your chest, I'll like you. So I went home and taped its hair on my chest. Amen. I'm just saying to us, you know, we've all had that experience of having our heart broken, right? And you know the saying that they say it's puppy love, and be careful because it'll turn into a dog's life, you know. But we've all been broken. We've all fallen. We've all been disappointed. Every one of us have found ourselves down and thinking like, man, this is the worst ever. I don't know if I can go on. I mean, life gives that to us sometimes, right? I know extreme sickness, that'll knock you low. That'll knock you down. That'll take away your ambition and your drive, and you're down. So the condition of the just man is that he's a candidate for getting up, because we all found ourselves down. The second thing I want to talk about, first was the condition of the just man. The second thing, and this is where it gets good to me, the constitution of the just man. You see, just like I said, the just meaning it's an equal balance. How does the just get up again? He just refuses to stay down. He just absolutely refuses to stay down. There are times where you need encouragement from outside sources. I watched a video this week of a professional baseball player that had been going through a tremendous, 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 tremendous slump. And he was a good player, and he had just fallen off bad. I mean, the cliff. He couldn't do nothing right, making mistakes in the field and at bat. It was just horrible. And it was for the Cincinnati Reds. I don't remember the guy's name. I'm sorry, I don't have the guy's name. But anyway, the fans booed. They had gotten so disenchanted with the man, they started booing every time he'd step up to the plate. And that just exasperated things. And one man on social media went on and he said, I want to challenge all the Cincinnati Red fans to cheer for this man regardless of his stats. And would you believe that they started cheering every time he come up, and that man popped out of that slump and he's hitting home runs, and it's amazing. His batting average just skyrocketed. Sometimes you need outside influences to help you get up, right? Sometimes you need somebody to believe in you and encourage you, and we ought to all try to be that for people, right? Every believer should bear one another's burdens. And when you find someone down, have an encouraging word. Yesterday, I went down to Schmidt to look at my truck, and there was a guy there working on his truck, and I walked over there and I helped him for a little bit, and this one man, he said, man, I hope this is going to work. I said, it's going to work. It's going to work. And I must have at least 15 times, not exaggerating, at least 15 times, I said, man, this is going to work. This is going to be great. This is going to work. And he got up in that truck, and he was really questioning whether it was going to work. I said, turn it over. It's going to fire up. And sure enough, it turned over and fired up. And he gave me a big old thumbs up. Hey, sometimes you need an encouraging word in your life, right? Amen. Come on, get with me this morning. Have you ever felt that way? I need somebody to come and help me get up. But the constitution of the just man says, if nobody encourages me, if nobody tells me that it's going to be okay, I refuse to stay down. I'm getting up. I'm getting up. I am getting up. Because you see, Brother Chuck, what I realize is staying down, it's not an option. It's not an option. Dying while you're down is not an option. We must finish well. We must finish well. It don't matter how you've what you've had, experiences, it don't matter, nothing. Hey, if you finish well, and if you don't believe that, think of the thief on the cross. I mean, lived an entire life as a thief, but on that day, amen, he reached out to the Lord, and Jesus said, this day, you'll be with me in paradise. Amen. The constitution of a just man just says, I refuse to stay down. If someone can encourage me, praise God for it. But if they don't, I'm going to be like David. I'm going to encourage myself in the Lord. I'm going to say, this is the day that the Lord hath made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. If I don't seem to be able to climb out myself, I'm going to put on the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. I'm going to look to God, and I'm going to bless the Lord with all my soul and everything that's within me. I'm going to do everything I can do to get up. The constitution of the just. Oh, and can I get just a little preachy this morning? Can I get just a little bit preachy this morning? We are living in a society that has very little constitution about themselves. Everybody has to be validated. Everybody has to be bragged on. Everybody has to have a trophy. Everybody has to be encouraged. I want to tell you something. Whatever happened to the people, amen, that said, this is what needs to be done, and I'm going to get up, and I'm going to do it. I read something this week that said, the saying was, emotions can be a great check engine light, but emotions is not a good GPS. Isn't that good? Emotions can serve as a great check engine light, but emotions are not a good GPS. If you have to wait till you feel like it to do the right thing, you're going to be in a mess. Hey, I'm getting up. Regardless how I feel, I'm getting up. Regardless of what doubts are coming, I'm getting up. Because I want to have a constitution about myself. The Bible puts it like this in Mark chapter 4 and verse 16. This is the parable of the sower and the four different types of soil. And this, listen to what this says. And these are they, likewise, and these are talking about the stony ground, which are sown on the stony ground, who when they have heard the word, immediately they receive it with gladness. And they have no root in themselves, and so endure but for a time. And afterwards, when affliction and persecution ariseth, for the word's sake, immediately they are offended. Could I just tell you this morning, you're going to have to grow past getting offended. If you're waiting for everybody to like you, you're going to have some down days. You're going to have some discouragement. You're going to have some people that don't like you. You're going to have some things that cause you to say, you know what, that wasn't right. Didn't make me feel good. Amen. But that's stony ground. Amen. That's the people that they get real excited when they hear something good. But they got thin skin. You better grow some thick skin. You better have some constitution about you. You better have something that's in you that says, hey, I'm getting up. It don't matter what comes and who don't come. I'm getting up. I'm getting up. Glory to God. I hope that some people here this morning, would before you leave here, that you'd say, I'm getting up. I'm getting up. I'm getting up to pray. I'm getting up to read my Bible. I'm going to up my level of commitment. I'm getting up. I'm going to have a relationship with God. I'm not going to let the devil keep me down. I'm not going to let the devil run my life with emotion and me being fickle and in and out and up and down all the time. I'm going to have some constitution about myself. Glory to God. I mean, this right here, you can tell I'm passionate about this because, hey, if, Lord help me. If you're easily offended, the chances of you going to heaven are very, very, very slim. The chances of you staying married are very slim. The chances of you being successful at most anything is very slim. And the reason being is because you have to have something inside of you that says, I'm getting up. I'm not going to be driven to and fro with every wind of my emotion. Well, I feel like going to church today, so let's go. You need to go when you don't feel like it, probably more than when you do feel like it. The devil cheats people. And if he knows that there's a chinch in your armor, trust me, he'll set up a fight between you and your wife on Sunday morning. You could get along all week long real good. And if the devil knows he's got a chance of keeping you out of the house of God, he will make you get pulled over by the police officer. He'll let all kind of stuff come up in your life. But you know what? If you just have constitution, hey, come on, devil, give it your best shot. I'm going anyway. After a while, he said, well, that didn't work. I better back up and try another tactic. Listen, friends. Hey, the conditions of the just man is we're all candidates to get up because we've all fallen. That's the condition. That's the condition of mankind. We are all messed up. But praise be to God, we can all get up. And secondly, the constitution of the just man that just says, hey, I refuse to stay down. I refuse to stay down. I was made to rise. I am called to look up and to get up. And I will, by the grace of God, answer the call. Amen. I would ignore my mom's call. Come on, Gary, it's time to get up. Because I love that slumber and sleep. I love that bed and them covers. And I was right in the middle of a good dream. Right? Hey, listen. I heard a call from heaven saying, get up. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you rest. I heard the call of the master. Come follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. I heard the call. I'm getting up. Lord, I'm getting up. By the grace and the help of God, I'm getting up. I refuse to stay down. Thirdly, not only the condition of the just, but the constitution of the just, but it takes courage, the courage of the just, the courage to get up. I will face fear. I will face desire to retreat. I will face the overwhelming inclination to play it safe. Like Moses told Joshua when he was getting ready to go into the promised land, the Lord said, be strong and of a good courage. Amen. And I tell you what, Joshua and Caleb, they never lost that tenacity. They never lost that gumption. They had courage. Amen. 40 years in being in the wilderness, and then come time to inherit the promised land. Amen. Caleb came to Joshua and he said, Joshua, I want that mountain. He said, I was 40 years ago, I saw it and I claimed it from God. Amen. And it's my mountain. And for 40 years in this wilderness, I have never lost the dream. I have never lost the vision. And God is able to help me, and I can go out and come in just like I could then. Give me that mountain. Amen. Listen, brothers and sisters, you got to have courage to be a Christian. You got to have courage. It used to be in America, we were the home team, but we're not the home team anymore. Amen. The devil is having his way in our houses of legislation, in our White House, in our government, in our positions of power. The devil is having his way in our places of education. The devil is having his way in corporations. The devil is having his way. And if you're going to be a Christian, you got to say, I'm getting up and I'm going to stand up for God, and I refuse to stay down, and I will let my voice be heard for God. You got to have courage today. Like never before, you have to have courage. You have to have courage to say, that ain't right. You have to have courage to say, the Lord said this. You have to have courage to say, I won't participate in that. You have to have courage. Hey, this whole COVID thing, and if you couldn't have enough discernment to see that that wasn't about controlling people, I don't know how to help you. Friend, I'm telling you, you got to have courage today in this world. You're going to have some courage to stand against the flow, to stand against the way things are going on your job. They're going to want to silence you. I mean, it's not a physical mask. But it's a mask nonetheless. You better not say that. You better not lift up Jesus. You better not talk about the Lord. You better not mention that you're a Christian. Hey, the courage of a Christian today is to say, I'm getting up. I'm getting up, and I'm going to stand up and be counted. You remember the story when Moses come down off the mountain and the children of Israel, Moses was gone for 40 days up there talking to the Lord and getting the commandments. And the people got restless, and they said, we got to have something here. So Aaron, make us a god. It's always interested me. He said, I just took the jewelry and threw it in, and this calf popped out. That's a lie. The people want to worship something, right? They want to worship something. So we better have something to worship. Moses come back down. He saw what had happened. He had some righteous indignation. And he said, who is on the Lord's side? And the Levites. They said, we didn't go along with this. And Moses drew a line in the sand, and he said, whoever's on the Lord's side, get on this side of this line. And the Levites stepped over the line. Brothers and sisters, we're coming to that place in America now. Amen. There's lines being drawn on workplaces. There's lines being drawn in family members. There's lines being drawn in education facilities. There's lines being drawn. You can't pray in school no more. I like what one guy said, as long as there's tests, there's going to be prayer in school. Amen? Hey, it takes courage to be just, to do the right thing. To do the right thing, it takes courage. But how many of you know this morning, if you take a step toward God, he ain't going to leave you out there on a limb hanging. That's right. Amen. I thought of Daniel. Daniel got tricked. They tricked King Darius into signing a decree that he didn't want to sign. He didn't really think through the whole ramifications of it. And they waited for Daniel to pray. And they come and they said, well, you've done signed the decree. And Daniel's praying to another god inside of you. You got to feed him to the lions. And so they fed him to the lions. It takes courage for Daniel to go on and open that window. How many people today say, well, I can pray behind the... I don't have to open the window. I can pray in my own house. I can pray in private. Right? Come on now. That's what's happened to the Christian world today in America. We're just praying in private. How many of you know if your Christianity ain't willing to open the window, you're not going to be able to have the miracle of seeing an angel shut the mouths of lions. Daniel prayed. They came, got him, threw him in the lion's den. I don't know how it went. But Daniel got a good night's sleep. You know who didn't get a good night's sleep? The king. He was up all night long, worried. Oh, what have I done? What have I done? What have I done? Can I just tell you, when you be courageous for God, it makes people nervous around you. King Darius came running the next morning. He said, take the lid off this dungeon. Take the lid off this pit. They took it off. He said, Daniel! Daniel said, oh, king, live forever. He said, tonight, the angels shut the mouths of these lions. My wife this past week was in Italy. They went to the Colosseum. And I asked my wife, I said, when you saw the Colosseum, did you have a sense of real just turmoil in your spirit, knowing that shortly after Christ left this earth, they were feeding Christians to lions in that Colosseum? And she said, well, I did, because I knew what happened here. But the tour guides, they didn't say nothing about it. They have totally rewritten history. Can I just tell you, friends? Hey, it took courage for them people to say, you know what? I'll stand for Jesus. Take my life. I'll stand for Jesus. But could I tell you, it was on the backs of those commitments and those type of people that that Christianity survived. Amen. It took those people to get it down, to get the message down to me. Because if all of them would have caved, amen, it would have been snuffed out. But because they refused to cave and they were courageous, amen, the message lived on. Amen. And it came all the way down to Gary Thomas. Amen. Who am I to say it'll stop here? No, I need to be courageous, because who knows who's coming after me that needs to hear that Jesus loves you. Amen. Jesus is the Savior of the world. I'm just telling you, friends, I'm getting up. Number one, the condition of the just. We're all candidates to get up because we've all fallen. Number two, the constitution of the just just says, I refuse to stay down. And number three, the courage of the just. I'll face my fears and refuse to quit. And fourthly and finally, I want to talk to you about the course of the just. The condition of the just, the constitution of the just, the courage of the just, and then the course of the just. What does this path look like for the just man that gets up and continues to get up and continues to get up? First of all, we get up for a reason. Amen. That's what David, little David, said when he stepped out there on that field and Goliath is out there, you know, screaming his blasphemous insults. David said, what have I now done? Is there not a cause? Hey, there's a reason, friend. I'm telling you this morning, you need to get up. There's a reason. Did you know that COVID, and I've said this to nauseam, I know, but since COVID, when the government tried to keep people in and keep people down, you can't go to work, you can't go to the grocery store, you can't do this and can't do that, and put fear on people, suicide rates went up over 45%. There's a reason to get up, friend. Everybody needs a reason to get up. Everybody needs a job. Everybody needs something that makes you go in the morning. Amen. People who live aimless, purposeless lives. Amen. They have nothing to live for. All that's left is death. What's the course of the just man? There's a reason to get up. Amen. There's a reason to get up. In Proverbs 12 and 13, the Bible says, the wicked is snared by the transgression of his lips, but the just shall come out of trouble. The devil wants to keep your life in turmoil. The devil wants to keep your life in drama. The devil wants to keep your life always with anxiety and always with frustration. Amen. But the just man says, I'm getting up and I'm coming out. I'm getting up and I'm coming out. I'm getting up and I'm coming out. I'm coming out of this trouble. It ain't always going to hurt this bad. It won't always be like this. Better days are ahead. There's a reason to get up, because if you stay down, trouble, you're an easy target for the devil. Amen. It's always harder to shoot a moving target, right? Get up and get to running for Jesus. Make it hard for the devil to hit you. Make it hard for the devil to hit you. Amen. 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 Oh, Lord, help me, Jesus. Amen. The Bible says about Jesus, he just went about doing good. He just went about doing good. Everywhere you saw him, he was doing good. He met trouble everywhere. But he just kept doing good. He kept doing good. He kept doing good. Hey, there's a reason the just needs to get up. There's a reason you need to get up and put a smile on your face. And fake it if you have to. Oh, I didn't think I'd go to a church the preacher told me to be a fake. Amen. Don't live your life in the present. Live it in the future. It may be tough right now, but better days are coming. You know that's what Jesus did? That's what Jesus did. He looked at the cross And he looked plumb through it, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him. What was before him? There was a cross before him. But on the other side of that cross, and is set down at the right hand of the Father. Amen. On the other side of the cross, amen, there's heaven. Amen. And I just want to say to somebody this morning, on the other side of what you're facing right now, there's joy. Amen. There's better times. There's laughter. There's something to look forward to. There's a reason to get up. I'm getting up this morning. Glory to God, I'm getting up. I'm getting up. Amen. What is the course of the just? The course of the just is to go forward. Forward from faith to faith. In Romans 1 and 16, the Bible says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also the Greek." For listen to this, verse 17. "For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith." Now, I saw something in this scripture that I'd never seen before. We always talk about the just shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. Well, what does that faith look like? We take this to mean the just shall live by his belief system. But let me show you something. The just from faith to faith. Now, what happened in between faith and faith? There might have been a valley. There might have been a hardship. There might have been a sickness. There might have been something that happened. But in the whole scheme of things, it's not even noteworthy to put it in and explain what happened, because the just went from faith to faith. As if to say, what happened to me that was hard was not even worth me noting, because my faith just took me from this mountaintop to that mountaintop, to that mountaintop, to that victory, to that hope, to that encouragement. My faith just kept me going. There's a lot of things that happen in the valley. And this is what I find with most people. They spend all their time thinking about, talking about, regretting, wanting sympathy for what goes on in the valley. But the just shall live by faith. The just says, I'm going to the next mountain. I'm going to the next God can. Let me tell you something, friends. I know it hurts, but God can heal. But God can heal. I know it's hard, but God can carry a load and he can make it lighter. I know it's fearful, but God can step out on the troubled sea and say, peace be still. Hallelujah to God. I might run around this church this morning. I'm telling you, friends, I got this burning in me. Listen, the just shall live by faith. Amen. And if you're down and if you're in between one of those faith to faith moments, amen, you need to say this morning, I'm getting up. I'm getting up. Amen. I just saw the healer coming down the road. It's time to get up. That man at the pool of Bethesda, Jesus come. They said, why are you here? He said, well, when the waters are troubled, I don't have anybody to help me. He said, get up. Amen. Peter and John on the road there, they come into the temple. Amen. That lame man on the side. And he said, give me something, give me something. And they said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee in the name of Jesus. Rise up and walk. Amen. That woman at the well. Amen. Jesus said, get up. That woman that was thrown down caught in the act of adultery. And Jesus wrote on the ground. He said, whom are thou, thy accusers? And she said, Lord, I have none. He said, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. It's time to get up. It's time to get up. It's time to get up. It's time for you to get out of your trouble. It's time for you to get up from your trouble. Stop talking about it. Start talking about faith. Start talking about what God can do. It's time. I'm getting up. Well, Chuck, you've been through some stuff this past year. A lot of stuff. Heart surgeries and all kinds of stuff. Amen. That didn't come to destroy you. That come to draw you close to the Lord. Brothers and sisters, I don't want this to sound like a motivational speech this morning. Amen. Because you in yourself and in and of yourself, you need help getting up. You need God to help you. But I want to tell you something. If you, through by the grace of God, will reach your hand out and say, Lord, I heard the call and I'm getting up. If you'll help me, I'm not going to do that no more. If you'll help me, I'm going to start doing this more. If you'll help me, I'm getting up. I'm going to tell you something. God will come and help you. I believe that with every fabric in my body. I believe that. I believe God will not leave you down. If you're wanting to get up and if you're reaching and saying, God, I'm getting up, the Lord will come by and he'll help you. What's the course? What's the course of the just? The course of the just is to go forward. The course of the just is from faith to faith. What's the course of the just? Forward. Amen. Onward and upward. Hebrews 10 and 38, the Bible says, now the just shall live by faith. But if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. But we are not of them that draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. Dave Johnson, he moved off the back pew. He told me today, he said, I moved up a pew. He said, don't get nervous. I said, I ain't getting nervous. I wish all these front pews was filled. Hey, man, we're not of them to draw back. Hey, I wouldn't sit on the back pew of a church. Amen. Come on up towards the front. If you went to the sports arena, you'd want to get as close as you could. If you went to the concert, you'd want to get as close as you could. And don't tell me you're worried about the sound because they scream and do all that stuff there. Hey, listen, we're not of them that draw back. We're going forward. Amen. I know that that's not what this is talking about. Your seat in the house. I know that. But it is a sign when people want to shrink back from. Hey, you need to step out in the light. Amen. The reason I put Jesus saves on the front bumper of my Peterbilt out there, because I don't want nobody having to guess whether I'm a Christian. There's hardly a week that goes by but what somebody don't honk their horn and give me a thumbs up when they see my truck. I believe there's a lot of Christians that's just looking for somebody that's got enough guts to come out and stand up. Amen. Listen, brothers and sisters, don't draw back from it. Don't shrink back from it. Amen. Alan told me about him getting a witness or talk to somebody about the Lord. Don't shrink back from it. Amen. Braden went to the DMV. You guys weren't here Friday night to hear his testimony. But Braden, I love my son. He loves God. He loves God. He's been praying, God help me. And he went to the DMV, I think it was Thursday, and had to get his license renewed and what all. And he went to the DMV. And before he went, the Lord spoke to his heart and said, you need to talk to people about Jesus when you're there. And he didn't know how to do that. So he just grabbed a bunch of tracts and he went around in the DMV handing out tracts to people. I am almost about to run to the tops of these pews. I'm telling you, friends, hey, somebody needs to get up and say, Lord, I'm not going to be ashamed of you. I'm not going to shrink back from it. God is calling us to be a lighthouse on a hill. He's calling us to be salt and light in this world. And the reason that Christians they're defeated is because many times they're not getting up. We've all fallen. I have fallen. I have fallen. I have fallen to temptation. I have fallen to discouragement. I have fallen. Condition of the just man is that he is fallen and it demands a get up. But just because I have fallen don't mean I have to stay there. You may have to reap what you've sown, but you don't have to continue to sow what you reap. There's better seed. There's seeds of joy. There's seeds of faith. There's seeds of the Word of God. Amen. Speak the Word of God into your situation. Amen. Tell the devil, get out from here. God's word said, submit myself to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from me. That's the word of God. Devil, you've come and you've tried to get me to stay down, but I'm refusing to do that by the grace and the help of God. Lord, I'm submitting myself to you. Now get out from here, Satan. And I'm getting up. They say that depression is a horrible, horrible, horrible condition. And when people get it so bad, they don't want lights on. They don't ever want to get out of bed. They don't want to talk to people. They want to just retreat. And I want to be very, very, very compassionate right now with what I say. And if you are there, or if you have been there, or you have a tendency to be there, I want to tell you today, God can help you get up. God can help you get up. You don't need more pills. You don't need more psychologists. You need a trip to the altar and let the Holy Spirit wash His love over you and show you that there's value in your life and you can get up this morning. If you're here today and you have fallen to temptation and you have sinned this week and you have done things that you knew that God did not want you to do, I'm telling you this morning, you can get up and come to this altar and you can repent of your sins and Jesus can save you and give you a new lease on life and you don't have to stay wallowing in that sinful behavior. If you feel like your marriage has fallen and there's not much worth saving there, I want to tell you today, the Lord is the mender of broken hearts. You can get up. You don't have to stay down. You can get up. The Lord will help you. I've talked to you today about having constitution. I've talked to you. I've tried to explain to you that there's a reason to get up. There's people that need you to get up. They need you to be up. I thank God for my dad. He was a stalwart in my life. He never second-guessed anything. He made a decision. He went for it. I mean, he was a picture of having just resolve. Got the most tenacity of any man I ever met in my life. Took him 5 years to get a permit just to build this gymnasium back here. 5 years he went through the process. Over and over and over, no at every turn. Just absolutely refused to take no for an answer. Made friends with everybody in regional building department. They knew him by name. And finally, like that little lady with the unjust judge, he said, not because I fear God or man, but because this woman's going to worry me to death if I don't give her what she wants. And the Lord said, that's the way you need to be in prayer. Hey, listen, friends, you need to keep praying for your lost loved ones. If you got a kid that's on his way to hell or on their way to hell, you get on your knees every day and say, God, I can't let them go. I refuse to let them go to hell. I refuse to let the devil have them. I'm getting up and I'm going to pray and I'm going to keep praying. My heart is grieved because I see people around me giving up way too early. You might just be one day away from a breakthrough. You might just be one day away from something good happening. You don't know what God might do. You don't know what God might do. Choose to stick around to the end and see how this thing plays out. I believe with all my heart, God is not going to leave us. Stand with me if you would. I don't know how long I preached. I hope I didn't wear you out too much. The last thing I wanted to say in the message was, if you're going to get up, it starts with you getting down on your knees. You have to humble yourself, and you have to cry out to God, and He will raise you up. I'm talking to people here today that have made a mess of things in your life. I know some of your situations, some of you I don't. I'm talking to some people this morning that you are really in a process of getting up. You are. And for you, I want to say, keep getting up. But if you're down today, the Lord wants to lift you. He wants to help you. You have to want it, though. You have to cry out for help. I'm not asking anybody this morning to stand up here and give your testimony of what you're going through. I'm going to give you full anonymity today. But you know where you are. You know what's going on in your heart, and you know what's going on in your life. And I would love it today if you would have enough desire, you would have enough gumption to overcome your apprehensions and make your way to this altar and bow your knee before God. So there's two things I want to give you an invitation for. Number one, if you feel trapped today and down in some sinful life of any facet, if you feel trapped and held down, I want you to have enough courage this morning to say, God, I want to get up. And in just a moment, I'm going to ask for everybody to come. And when we all come, I want you to come with them. Secondly, I'm going to ask every one of you today, are you willing to get up for Jesus? Are you willing to get up and get out of the slump? Get out of the stupor. Get out of the discouragement. Get out of the bashfulness. Get out. You're willing to get up and get to it. I'm going to ask you to come. So I want us to pray, and then I'm going to invite you. Heavenly Father, I ask you right now for the Holy Spirit to work in the hearts and minds and lives of everyone standing here this morning. And Lord, I believe that you are calling us, wake up, get up. And you are inviting us to get moving, whether to an altar for salvation or to an altar of surrender. You're inviting us to come. And I ask, Lord, right now that every person under the sound of my voice would respond to your call. In Jesus' name. I'd like for everyone today to come to this altar, and let's find a place to pray. Come on.